the Vice Chancellor, Dean of the Faculty of Medicine, Deans of other faculties, academic staff, as well as heads of non-academic staff. First, let me thank the University of Pennsylvania for having invited me to speak to you here today. I know today is a very important day for you, a memorable day, an exciting day. So let me first congratulate you in the words of Sir William Osler. The choice of calling, which means profession, which offers a combination of intellectual and moral interests found in no other profession. This is maybe a beginning for journey. However, a journey is a thing that you start at one place, it's a passage from one place to another, or from youth to maturity, or through time. However, what you are going to go through is going to be more of an odyssey. The odyssey is a long, complicated journey, often a quest. You want to achieve something for a short or a long-term goal, and it may be personal or shared and often changing. It may be a fulfilling and a meaningful spiritual or even a psychological journey. So we are starting on this odyssey today. You may go through the second MB, third MB final, MBBS, get a job, marry, children, specialize, or even migrate. Yeah, let's face reality. First of all, you are here because of motivation. You were motivated to be a doctor. So this motivation is through inspiration. And you may have been inspired by your parents who are here today, a relative or family. May not be a movie star or a sports star, and of course, probably not a politician. But these are people whom people get motivated. Community leaders, yes, maybe, and your teacher. So with that, you need commitment. That is the most important, especially for medical students. And then with that commitment comes hard work. Just because you are committed, it doesn't mean that you are going to end up getting whatever. And it may come through dreams, through sacrifice, through ability, through positive thinking, which is the most critical of everything. Think positive all the time. You need to be able to focus on things, on your studies, and then entrepreneurship. You should be able to multitask, that means doing a few things at the same time. And also you need lateral thinking as well as abstract thinking. And then you need to acquire knowledge, then you need to acquire skills of examining patients maybe, and communicating with patients. And then the most important is the correct attitude, which we cannot give to you in a lecture. And then only will you succeed. The final achievement will be success. It's important to realize that success doesn't just come and find you. It's not a lucky thing. You have to go out and get it. First of all, I think you are all excited, but you don't know what you are in for. I can remember as a medical student, it was a daunting task for me trying to remember the Greek names and the Roman names of all these bones and tuberosities and all sorts of things. And we were never told about study methods at that time, but I'm just going to go through some of those things which will be helpful to you. In Sri Lanka, we have educational method of knowledge-based ability, that is ability to reproduce. Swallow, vomit. Versus logical thinking processes which we don't make use of. Which I'm also addressing the teachers at this point. For example, We can write, I didn't want to put any medical topics because you are not mature enough for that. You may be asked to write an essay on the Sri Lankan economy. On the other hand, you can write a critical analysis of the downfall of the Sri Lankan economy. It's something else that it allows a lot of logical thinking to come in. So that is how we should, of course, for the teachers, we should get the children involved. And for example, I'm going to the Australian entry to medical schools. They don't do the physics, chemistry, biology. They may do English, Chinese, and in future, Sinhalese, mathematics. Medical students, entry to medical school, mathematics, logic, and of course, biology is also there. So remember, you don't have to go through that process. And of course, compulsory committee service, because that is something that will develop your attitudes properly. Now this is a cartoon. I know you can't see the little letters, but I'm going to magnify it. It says that this is the factual recall method we are always listing. We tell the dogs also to do that. Sit, stay, heal, or fetch. Right? Never think or innovate. Never be yourself. Asiri. In your system, we want students to reproduce what we want. Try to make a difference in that, in the system which I have been responsible for 35, 40 years. Let's look at how the memory and the learning methods work. You see, it is interesting to realize that you can remember only a few things at a given moment. How many items are there in your conscious mind or in your working memory is only 3 or 4. Earlier it was thought to be 7, but now they think it's only 3 or 4 at any given time, which is equivalent to the RAM in a computer. People who understand the computer will know the RAM, random access memory, which is that, right? And then what we can do is, because of this limitation in memory, what we can do is what is called chunking. For example, it is a term that is referring to process of taking individual pieces of information or chunks and grouping them in larger units, right? And by grouping, you can improve the amount of information you can remember. I will give some example. Everybody does chunking. Everybody. Even your grandfather knows about chunking, because if you take a telephone number, are you going to remember these 10 digits? No. What you will remember is +94, which is Sri Lanka. 777 is dialogue, even that you don't have to remember. What you need to remember is only 2. 885098, that's it. So you are actually, although you are remembering 10 digits, you are remembering only maybe 2 digits. Two items of information, right? So that is what is chunking. I will also talk about, if you are looking at the diseases of a patient, you don't have to get highly excited about what I'm going to say now, but, right? A disease can be due to infective processes. You know, you have done biology, so you know that. It can be an inherited process, or it may be a congenital process. It may be autoimmune, that is your body reacting against your own. It may be a malignant, which is a cancer. Or it may be drugs, right? So already we have chunked the disease processes. Now that chunk can be further reduced in further chunks, such as infective can be viral, bacterial, fungal, parasitic, and then each of these can be further chunked, right? But all these, each of these things can be chunked, and the viral can be chunked into rotavirus, coronavirus, and so on and so forth. E-tec, E-pec, E-shigella, and so on and so forth. So you remember about 100 things through a process of chunking, which you start at the first level. And then each one, then you will remember. So each of these will be important. Then there are what are called retrieval cues. I'm sure all of you are using this, but maybe unconsciously. I used to do that when I was a student, but probably didn't understand why I was doing it. the retriever cues are, it's a hint or a prompt or a signal that you have to remember something. I'll give a very simple thing, because some people think that pushing information into your head over and over again is going to be the best way. It may not be, although it helps at times, but you know, it's like hitting your head with a hammer. Now, what is retrieval is the process of recalling knowledge, information in the long-term memory that is there, where it is encoded to recall. It is encoded in your long-term memory to recall with a hint, right? And a retrieval cue may be a signal or a prompt, which may be a name of a person, an event or a mnemonic that unlocks the long-term memory. Now, I'll give a few examples of very simple cues which you use day to day, not in medicine. For example, you have to remember the name of Paranavithana. You keep on forgetting. So all you have to do is you remember his old cow, his old house, and then remember only the Vithana part of it. And so he becomes Paranavithana. Or, you know, some people find the people are using Uber and Zip. Sometimes they can't remember what the Zip thing is, so remember a Zip. Then, Ibikava, the inhaler medicine, is no longer available. And if you really want to remember this, think of a Ibaka, Ibika, right? So these are retrieval cues. And this is a very interesting thing which I did as a student, which I didn't realize at that point. But now these are the two dengue carrying mosquitoes, Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus. Now how to differentiate? Now your parasitology gurus will ask minute question where this patch is or this long thing is and all that they will ask. So you have to remember. I don't know whether they are that now, but so what we did was we remembered the name Albert Gunasekara, who was one of our senior students. He was a dark, tall fellow, right? He's a physician today. And so we remember him bare bodied, and we used to think of him having a white line on his back, and also the albopictus also has a white line on his back. So we connected the two and connected the Albert to albopictus. So these are retrieval cues. It's a very complicated retrieval cue, but it's a very good example of a retrieval cue. So you have to start making use of them. Then there are mnemonics. For example, the day of onset of a febrile onset of rash in a febrile child, which is the day that the rash happens in a child with fever. German small children scratch marks terribly. So I won't go into detail. You forget about clinicals. You haven't even started your pre-clinicals. So it's like you have it that if you remember the top one, then you remember German means first day, scarlet fever, smallpox, second day, chickenpox, right? Second day, measles on fourth day, and typhus, typhoid, so on. So you remember that mnemonic. I'm going to come back to mnemonic. Then what is also critical, which has been very part of my success in my academic career, is to make short notes. And I have taught others, including my sons, to do that, and they have been successful. Now, when you go to your block, right, you will have a long segment like this, and you will get scared. Carpals, bones are organized into two grooves, the proximal and distal root, and so on and so forth. Now, this actually, I went berserk. I thought I was going mad. And then all you have to do is to highlight or underline the important content. And when you do that, only this is left. Rest of it is nonsense. So, that is a short note that you write. Right? I may not be very accurate in this, but still, anatomists might contest with me, but still, right? So this is what it is. This is all you need. And then you can supplement it with a diagram. So you have a book, and then you put this short note, maybe a diagram, right, and also add a mnemonic to it, such as she looks too pretty, try to catch her. She means scaphoid, looks means lunate, right, too means triquetrum, and so on. But I must warn you, There are dirty mnemonics in the block, only meant for the boys. So you have this book, you write it down. But at the same time, today's day and age, we are all having iPads and iTabs and Samsungs and so on and so forth. You can have a digital notebook as well. So you can get additional information from the internet and get all this on the carpal boards. So how am I going to forget anything if you remember like this? So you can make either onto the manual notebook, you paste it, or have a digital notebook. Then there are learning styles. And the learning styles can be, you can use, you have your eyes, you have of course your nose, your mouth, your ears, and your touch. So some of these faculties can be made use of. Of course you don't lick, but to learn, but still, right? So you can use all these things. Therefore, we should use, augment our learning processes with PowerPoint, what I'm doing now, right? You can make your own PowerPoints with your lecture that you get. Animations, graphic illustrations, charts which can be your own, handouts with illustrations, of course for the teachers, right? Audio recordings, which, I mean, I remember when I was a student, there was a guy who actually came from Peradeniya to Colombo and stayed for 10 years to pass out. He used to record, those are the initial days of a school recorder, Grundig recorder, and he used to record the lectures, and then he'd keep under the pillow and then sleep. No wonder he had to stay for 10 years, right? So, similarly, without the teacher's knowledge, you may be able to do it, but I'll talk about it later. And then there are what are called text-to-speech conversions, right? Now, this is another long thing about atopy, which is an allergic system. Instead of learning all this in terms of words, you can also have graphic representation. Asthma is a part of this. I am actually translating this phrase or this paragraph into a diagram. You can call it eczema, allergies, cata or allergic rhinitis, which is atopy. So if you have this diagram, you can always write this essay, no problem. And then, this is something that I read when I was chairman of Child Protection Authority, violence in society, domestic violence, violence against children, all connected. Then there is violence of war, that time the war was there, and the media violence, and alcohol and drugs. So now if you have this diagram, which affects the child at the end of it, right? If you have this diagram, you can write a chapter on violence in society. Right? You just have to improve it through that chunky process. What I'm doing here is also a sort of chunking in terms of a graphic. So, this is another thing. I have to go off this now. Now there is a thing called speech to text to speech, and in that
Atopy refers to the genetic tendency to develop allergic diseases such as allergic rhinitis, asthma, and atopic dermatitis, eczema. Atopy is typically associated with heightened immune responses to common allergen.
So this is a way of listening to something which is in text on a computer, which you can do, and the new systems enable you to do that. There is something called a speech bubble in Word and in PowerPoint as well. All these programs will have them. Now, it would be useful for teachers, now I'm talking to the teachers, to make PowerPoint presentations with animations and graphics so that people remember, to allow students to photograph slides without disturbing others. Again, if the flash is going on, it might be a problem, but the faculty had to deal. I'm just giving ideas. Make presentations available in the computer center. I know it's a lot of you are doing it, but I would prefer it to be a PDF version because people can otherwise manipulate it. and allow students to record, provided the lecturer don't talk about unnecessary things, including politics. Now, it's also important to realize, the Honorable Vice Chancellor mentioned about not all being able to go through the process. Because there are certain reasons why people, because you have jumped a huge hurdle to come in here. If you can't get out of here, there's something wrong. What is wrong? You may be dyslexic. I will talk a little bit on that. You may have Asperger's disease or autistic spectrum disorder. Right? A lot of people, us have it. Right? Maybe myself as well. Right? Then depression due to the stress. And also some of you will have mental disorders, which is nothing, you are not to be blamed. And none of these conditions have any relationship to your intelligence. Because your performance may be poor because of these things, but it has nothing to do with your intelligence. Now, this is what dyslexia is. Some people, when they read, they will see the words like this in different ways. Sometimes you can't read in dyslexia. And this is another way in which you see the words go up and down and reverse and mirror images and all those things can be part of dyslexia. Then students themselves should try to identify their own weaknesses. Then friends will be able to identify the weaknesses of their friends. And then there should be teachers who will also understand, and there should be designated teachers who would find ways of helping. And I beg RCD to develop a system including doing research to look at the prevalence of these disorders among the poor performers so that we can help them. Because there's a lot of international literature, and of course there is no need to be ashamed of it, because it's something that is you, and parents also should be able to talk to the teachers sometimes if there is a need. Now comes the million-dollar question, the youth. All of you, I presume, are youth. Nobody is 40 or 45. But adolescence or youth is complicated by abstract thinking processes. They think in not laterally so much, very abstract. And there is a lot of parental authority and societal pressures. There is a lot of stress from parents. Do it, do it, do it, do it, you have to do it. And then there is also anti-authority feeling, which comes from the parental stress. You are anti-parents, therefore you are anti-teachers as well. And there is peer pressure, others who are pushing you into certain things, as well as to perform better than other peers. We have labile emotions. People will cry for the slightest thing, or you will get angry for the slightest thing. And amongst other, there are other features which I am not going to list here. Now, it is easy to convince or brainwash idealistic youth. Basically, you are idealistic. You want everything to be ideal, not the reality. Right? And they can use historical stories, talk about bravery, retribution, polygamy, and so on. Religion, race, and uncertain future are main aspects that will be manipulated by people who need power. So youth violence has a huge drain on our economy, not only due to immediate effects, but also due to long-term consequences on mental health of that person, not the country. We see this stuff of scene every day. Violence, physical or mental violence. And then we also get involved in this type of activity. Right? And face these consequences. We are facing these consequences. We are asking for trouble. But what is important to realize is who is manipulating you, who is using you as a puppet, rukal. First of all, you'll find we are shouting freedom, right, as students or doctors, But then the unions are puppeteering you. And who's puppeteering the union? The local politicians. And who's puppeteering the local politicians? The international politicians. This time, you know, the famous guy who is there, right? So this is the process. And you are only the itta, right? Alright? Okay, you have to understand that. So trauma faced during childhood, manifesting as violence in youth, is often manipulated by others for their political or personal gain. Ragging is violence. You have to understand. Ragging is abuse. Now these are some pictures I got from the internet. Ragging involves abuse, humiliation or harassment of new entrants, especially when it comes to psychological or physical torture. Ragging causes physical injuries, including permanent injuries, long-term psychological issues, dropping out of university, and suicide. We have history of that. Now, if you take a child, as you are abused or bullied at home, then you become a bully in school or get bullied in school, which have long-term psychological issues. Then, as you are a senior, you find that the juniors are a threat to you. You want to maintain the senior hierarchy. We are the seniors, you are the juniors, so you listen to us, right? That is there. So to do that, they make use of some of the psychological issues they have faced as children, and they start ragging you, which leads to psychological and physical and injury and suicide. Now, there is an important concept called the Stockholm syndrome, where physical or psychological abuse joint with kindness, so-called kindness, involves some sort of a bonding. In other words, they rag you, humiliate you, and then go to the canteen and buy you a plain tea. Right? That is the bonding process. Right? That is the kindness. Or they give their notes to you. Right? And so you won't even give evidence against them at any inquiry. That's the process. Now what is important is, right, you have to realize is that when in children, child abuse, maybe sexual abusers, adults who offer children support also while abusing them, which leads to this Stockholm bonding, right? And therefore, the children won't give evidence against the adult abusers in court. That can happen. On the other hand, the Stockholm syndrome of kindness will also be used to recruit you into various political organizations. So they rag you, humiliate you, and they are also kind to you, and then take you into their classes or whatever that they have. Right? And that would mean they start ragging the next year, which is a vicious cycle. You get ragged, you rag next year. And then there will be a few who has hates that and start an anti-ragging campaign, which I did 48 years ago, probably the first in history. Remember that there is an act, a criminal act, where ragging is classified as a crime, imprisonable for 2 years of 5 years, 10 years, or even 5 years, depending on the thing. So you better know that, be aware of that, and please, not for today, but in a year's time, don't become a bully or abuser next year when you are seniors, please. Good governance. Now I want to tell you a little bit about the country or governance or whatever, right? Now, good governance in Sinhalese means yaha palani. Right? I'm not saying anything against a government or a political party. I'm just trying to say what good governance is. Okay? Please don't misunderstand me. In good governance, people have to be transparent. They have to obey the rule of the law. So in the university, you can't do hanky-panky things or hang your ethics. Right? That is transparency. Rule of the law, there are rules in the university, as the vice chancellor told you, there are rules and regulations. You have to stick to it. You can't break those rules. And then you have to be accountable. So if you break those laws, If you are going to get suspended or sacked from the university, you better be able to face it. Alright? So that is the main thing about good governance. In the middle of it, you get what is called equality, where different groups, social groups or religious groups or ethnic groups, there should be equality and inclusiveness, as well as participative and responsive, where you also can put the input into the same thing. Of course, there will be monitoring. So the proctor is there to monitor. So your other academic staff and doing exams is a way of monitoring you. Alright? So, as I told you, I am not talking about politics, right? So, everybody has to be transparent in actions and accountable to it and the rule. And when I say everybody, it has to be everybody. And, for example, I am giving examples. We as individuals should be transparent to ourselves with our parents, or the parents should be transparent to the sibling, the children, right, partner, and so on and so forth, or society. Then we should act within the norms of family law, family norms, or government laws. We should be accountable for whatever wrong we have done, either in the family, or in society, or in government. So we have to be also transparent where we are working. So, if you take the pyramid, right, the bottom is you and I, the middle is the administrative processes like the dean and the vice chancellor, and the top would be the top, right? So, what will happen is, in that, you have to have good governance at every level. You can't have good governance only at the bottom. You have to be at top also, right? And therefore, there should be a monitoring process, right? And then, make people accountable, right? That level also, there will be another monitoring process from top. Of course, the top, here I am going to talk about only the politicians here, which I have not deleted, but there should be a process, right? And in fact, in this country, we have dismantled all the monitoring processes of politicians. That's why it doesn't happen. Of course, at the elections, the accountability will be met. We all should have a vision and a mission. Your vision may be to get MBBS. You may want to be a pediatrician, or you want to maybe be a GP. So that's a vision. And then you have to, your mission is going through this process. But you can have other missions as well after you qualify or while you are in the medical school. Right? Each one should have a vision which is able to project towards a time-bound mission. For example, exams are on this day, so it should be time-bound, your mission. So, you can fantasize things, imagine things, dream about things, but realism is important. And also, you should be able to focus on without too much of distraction. And you should have enough facts or knowledge, which is the, what you study. Right? And you should be able to analyze your needs, your weaknesses and strengths. If you are weak in a particular subject, you should be able to study more on that. Right? But not neglected where you are strong on, and so on. You need to have a strategic plan, you need to have gain knowledge and develop skills, and above all, correct attitudes. Akalpa must, are a must. It's useful to dream, to fantasize, but realism with the feet on the ground is much more important than your dreams. To illustrate the concept of making fantasies into reality, I just give a few of my examples, my personal odyssey. When you embark on a mission, Churchill said, "You will never reach your destination if you stop and throw stones at every dog that barks." So there will be a lot of dogs that bark at you, including your batchmates, maybe sometimes occasionally your teachers maybe, but maybe your relations, your gummy fellows, right? Who will bark? Don't try to stop and start throwing stones. Forget about them. Ignore them. And their first mission was, I got a donation of a computer in 1992. I did demographic research in the board, and I gave the World Medical Association oration the next year. And then one of the facts was that there was a very high neonatal mortality. I lobbied and got JICA funding of $75,000 in 1995, 3 years after I finished, started the project. And then I set up the first pediatric intensive care unit in the south and the second for the country. We also found a high cardiac mortality under 5, and we contacted a Leicester cardiac team, Mr. Dr. Ranjit Lianagi and Mr. Richard Fermin, in 1996, and we started the first pediatric cardiac surgery program in the country, specific pediatric cardiac surgery in Goa, not in Colombo. And these are pictures of the neonatal intensive care unit. And these are pictures of the foreign team that came and worked as us. I was much younger, I had more hair on my head. And of course, the president at that time came and paid tribute to it. And these are some politicians as well who also get credit for it. And then there was this, so these are two main projects I have done when I was involved. And then this battered baby syndrome, which was known earlier, which was in 1992. Right? So denied in Sri Lanka because we all said we are in a Dharmista society, no child abuse. And of course the first medical report was by us. I was only the third author, right? But it was the first description. I was then got involved and saw more and more patients who were physically beaten and with broken bones. And then I found that there's a high proportion of sexual abuse among children. And then I wrote this book. Right, this is part of my odyssey, part of my voyage towards whatever I had to achieve. And then, with agitation, a presidential task force was appointed, a National Child Protection Authority was proposed, it was established, and then obtained a grant from the British High Commission. Right, these are paper articles, again a mission, with a mission it says, right. And that is how the National Child Protection Authority was established, through the initial research that was done, right? So all of you can have a vision and a mission, whether it's small, big or mega, and some of you may want to be the president of the country or the Minister of Health. Now, in terms of future as a doctor, when you become a future doctor, wherever the art of medicine is loved, this is what Hippocrates said, there is also love for humanity. You understand what I'm saying? You may want a happy life, want to be highly educated, perfect, rich, and a popular doctor. But being rich and powerful and a doctor in demand may make you unconsciously arrogant, egoistic, self-centered, and then harmful to others. And narcissism is an extreme form of your self-involvement or admiration of yourself and the lack of regard for others. Now don't be that, right? You can achieve all these things but not that. And therefore personal success is important, money is useful, personal happiness is critical, but a meaningful life, a fulfilling life, and a mindful life is also important. And these are three main objectives. A meaningful life means a realistic life with feet on the ground, humble with correct attitudes, be mindful of your work, attitudes, and also attitudes to colleagues and patients, share your skills with others, have a positive impact on society, be content of your contributions, and when you are skillful, able to communicate and confide and trust others, you will have pressure from the other side, from the family healthcare businessmen, and need for money, which will make you wanted and in demand, and greed, which can lead to unethical commercialization of a profession. Unethical, not commercialization, unethical commercialization. Therefore, this is another saying, as a doctor, the people will trust you, confide in you, and appreciate your efforts. You can do amazing things for people if you don't let the system get you down, what I demonstrated earlier. Do not unethically commercialize your profession or politicize your profession. We come to where we started, or we are, this is the end of that odyssey that we started, end of my lecture as well, right? But do not forget your roots, where you came from, your village, your relations, your friends and society that you came from. Don't forget them. Your parents who nurtured for you, right? There are medical students who don't want their parents to come to medical school to meet them because they are ashamed of them, right? Don't do that. Don't forget your parents. They cared for you from the time of conception. And your teachers, past and future, who have fertilized your minds. And last, the society that made it all possible. Because as the Vice Chancellor said, it's the society that is spending on your education. Therefore, we have no moral right to refuse treatment by going on strike, right, against the society. Because it's the society that has spent on you, so you can't refuse to treat society. Thank you.